Penguin Random House Audio presents Code Talker, the first and only memoir by one of the original Navajo code talkers of World War II, by Chester Nez, with Judith Schiess Avila. Read for you by David Colacci. Publisher's note: the appendix to this book, The Navajo Code Talker's Dictionary, has been included in PDF format on the first audio CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in a digital format, please refer to www.tantor.com, keyword Code Talker, and click on the PDF Extra 1 to access this material.
Foreword by Senator Jeff Bingaman. The memoir that follows is the most recent example of courage from Chester Nez. Long ago, he and his fellow Navajo code talkers were brave enough to leave the homes they loved to support a country that often spurned them. With intelligence, skill, and courage, they were a significant factor hastening the Allied victory in the Pacific. Employing the Navajo language for secure communication was a masterstroke that was successful only because Navajos themselves were recruited to serve as Marine Corps radio operators. Using the Navajo language, they developed and transmitted the code, which proved unbreakable. When the war was over, they continued to protect the code and their part in the victory until it was declassified 23 years later after the conclusion of World War II. Deemed top secret for decades, it is appended to this memoir. Only in 1968 did their contribution become known. In 2000, the Congress of the United States, in an effort to recognize and honor the heroic contributions of the Code Talkers, authorized that the Congressional Gold Medal be struck in their honor. In July 2001, in the rotunda of the Capitol, the presentation was made, and long-delayed thanks expressed. Chester Nez, one of the 29 original Code Talkers, offers this memoir of his American life before, during, and after World War II. It is a treasure, and so is he. Jeff Bingaman, United States Senator for New Mexico. Senator Bingaman and Senator Daniel Inouye of Hawaii sponsored the Honoring the Navajo Code Talkers Act in 2000. Prologue. I'm no hero. Chester Nez chuckles. I just wanted to serve my country. I just wanted to serve my country. To appreciate that remark, you need to know a little modern Native American history. In Chester's home state of New Mexico, Native Americans were still denied the vote when he volunteered as a Marine in World War II. Nevertheless, the military called upon Chester and fellow Navajos to devise a code that many analysts believe assured the United States' defeat of Japan in the South Pacific. Chester, 86 years old when I met him, now 90, is the only living original code talker. These were the 29 men who first devised the famous Navajo code and took it into battle against the Japanese. I try to picture this soft-spoken man in battle, an image that is always elusive. Instead, I see the vast expanses of his grandmother's land in New Mexico, with Chester, a tiny figure in the sun-baked landscape, herding sheep. Or I see the little boy who, at boarding school, was punished for speaking his native Navajo language, the very language that led to the famous code. When Chester, his son Mike, and I first met, we did not know that we'd create this book. An interview was what Chester and Mike had in mind. But talking for a couple of hours wasn't enough. I have never been in the military, and I am not Navajo. I did not know what to expect. So, like a fisherman, I cast my questions into vast unknown waters and pulled in an assortment of remarkable narratives. I first learned about Chester's role as a World War II code talker. The saga of the devastating war, over before I was born, captivated me. Then, hearing of his childhood in the checkerboard area in New Mexico, where a difficult life made him strong, pulled me back even further into a rich history. Everything began to fit together, each piece a necessary part of the whole. After thinking about it for a couple of days, Chester agreed to let me write his biography. But early on, he expressed some concerns. What if his story wasn't long enough to fill a book? He hadn't done any more than so many other men, so why were we writing about him? What if he forgot something important or remembered something incorrectly? What if his story wasn't exciting enough? Listeners of this memoir will realize, I hope, that Chester's fears soon proved baseless. Chester grew up on the checkerboard. His family's land sat side by side with spreads owned by Anglo-Americans, Hispanics, and other Navajos, not far from the huge Navajo Nation, commonly called the Navajo Reservation, that straddled the borders of Arizona, New Mexico, and Utah, and bordered on Colorado. Life in the Navajo Nation was difficult when Chester was a child. Life on the checkerboard was even more difficult. "We could go for 3 or 4 days without eating," Chester recalls. "Everything always comes last to the checkerboard. My sister Dora's house is wired for electricity, but she still has no power. They say it is coming soon." That was in 2007. Dora's house is located on the checkerboard land where Chester grew up. She died in 2008, still with no electricity. The account of Chester's life is important because it tells of a people whose deeds have too often been overlooked. I believe this is the first book to tell of the full life experience of a code talker who grew up as most Navajos did then, herding sheep, attending boarding school, eking out a day-to-day living. This is significant. In Code Talker, the memoir of World War II Navajo Marine Chester Nez, Chester takes a close look at his childhood, a childhood that, in broad strokes, represents the formative years of an entire generation of Navajos. Code Talker examines the courage and spirit that imbued the Marines in World War II, who developed and utilized the famous unbreakable Navajo Code. In doing this, it highlights a significant contribution made by an indigenous culture. The multifaceted Navajo language enabled that code to be developed, demonstrating how the diversity that defines our nation, diversity of color, of background, of language, contributes to our strength. There are some things Chester remembers that don't jibe completely with history as read in a textbook. That is to be expected, especially concerning the wartime events experienced by the Code Talkers. The Code Talkers were such a well-kept secret that their very existence was classified for 23 years following the close of hostilities in World War II. In 1968, when their contributions to the war effort were finally declassified, their history was available to be recorded for the first time. Much of this history relied on memories that were nearly a quarter of a century old. This is Chester Nez's saga. We record here his recollection of events. Where his memories diverge from accepted history, his memories take precedence. We've worked hard to accurately depict the wealth of information Chester remembers. Also, some of the practices and events that Chester recalls diverge somewhat from traditional Navajo practices. We have striven to footnote these divergences throughout the book, but once again we have recounted things as Chester remembers them. It is impossible to neatly label and codify the customs of the Navajos, now numbering more than 250,000 people. Divergence is inevitable. As our interviews progressed, I began to write. But something was wrong. It wasn't Chester, it was me. I'd finished Chester's biography before I realized that his story wasn't mine. It was his. Chester is alive, and this book needed to be his memoir, not a biography written by someone else. So I listened to the tapes again. By then we had recorded more than 75 hours. The calm, modest voice on those tapes reminded me that, traditionally, Navajos are private people. They don't seek praise or applause when one has simply done his duty. In the telling of his story, Chester's desire is simple. He hopes that those listeners who are not Native American will appreciate and understand something outside their own experience, and that those who are Native American will find a source of pride in their heritage. I listened. Chester's voice was strong, his multifaceted story riveting. Here it is. Judith Schiess Avila, May 2011. Chapter 1. Guadalcanal Invasion. November 4, 1942. Approaching Guadalcanal. Nothing ever dried. My damp combat uniform chafed at the back of my neck. Water ran down my forehead and into my eyes. A trickle meandered down my back as I stood on deck in the dark. The railing of the transport.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.